This is an oral history interview conducted for the Witness to War, Serving a Nation project at Nauset Regional High School on Cape Cod, Massachusetts. Please state your full name and community in which you reside.
Byron Richard Fulcher, 425 Queen Anne Road, Harwich, Mass.
Mr. Fulcher, where and when were you born?
I was born in Hyannis, Barnstable County. And it was 1948, November 25th.
So you grew up on Cape Cod?
Yes.
What was it like growing up on Cape Cod back then?
Actually, in my day, it was a lot of fun.
Wow.
We invented all of our own games and everything. We developed the railroad tracks used to run all the way down to the camp, Army camp in Wellfleet. So we formed what you call the Hole in the One gang, and we used to hang around the railroad tracks and make believe that we, robbed the train and stuff like that. But we were able to, my grandmother owned a lot of property, so we were able to ride horses. Dr. Leach up the road near Fort Hill, he had a farm, he had donkeys, horses, the whole nine yards. We would sneak up there and ride them. We had basically almost like a grocery store at our fingertips because we had blueberries, apples, pears, cranberries, blackberries to eat all spring, summer, and fall because they were right in our general neighborhood. And basically, a little later on, our house burnt in Eastham. So we ended up moving to Chatham.
Wow. So where did you go to school?
Chatham.
And what did you want to do for a living when you were younger?
Well, that was sort of up in the air. Because I grew up without a father. So it was basically survival. And it's one of those things that you did what was necessary to survive. So we made it a point to, we mowed cemeteries. I worked at a garage. And I never had the opportunity that a lot of other children had as far as being able to go to a tech school, college, and stuff like that. So shortly after I got out of high school, I got drafted.
So so when did you find out that you were going to be a soldier?
When Uncle Sam sent the notice.
So so just for the sake of the interview, what conflict did you serve in?
The Vietnam.
So when you were drafted, what were your opinions about the war? And have they changed today?
Well, my father served in World War II. My brother Charlie was a soldier, and my brother Huey and my brother Barry were also. We both got drafted at the same time, so I believed in it. I believed it was the right thing to do. And Uncle Sam sort of, when you went to basic training, Uncle Sam made it a point to say, this is your duty, this is what needs to be done, and stuff like that. So it was just something you did without even questioning.
So can you tell me about the day that you left for Vietnam?
Well, in one way it was exciting. We flew over in an airplane instead of going by boat, and it was, we went to Alaska, and then we jumped to Japan, and then from there we flew down to Cameron Bay, Vietnam, and when we got there, they were under a mortar attack.
What's
a mortar attack. It's, in other words, it's when they're firing rounds in onto the runway when you're landing. In other words, they're trying to blow up the plane.
Wow.
So basically, this was our introduction to the Vietnam War. So we were told to basically get out of the plane and get undercover as quickly as possible.
Who was firing on you?
What's that?
Who was firing?
The Viet Cong and NVA.
So earlier you mentioned that Uncle Sam would mention this, or Uncle Sam would ask you to do this. What do you mean by Uncle Sam? Do you mean like
the federal government?
Okay, I didn't know if you meant specific posters or a specific person.
No.
So what position did you serve in?
What position?
Yes.
Well, basically, I started out as a E3, which, you know, go private, first class, then it's corporal, then it's E3, E4, E5, and then on up. I started out as an E3, and as I was there longer, I moved up in rank. I started out basically doing whatever was necessary. We were building buildings. We were building the runways for the helicopters to land and stuff like that. Anything that we needed to do to get the company ready, as far as, you know, protecting it and stuff like that. We also built 5 bunkers, and each one of those bunkers had 15,000 sandbags in them.
Well, do you know why they had the sandbags?
Why they?
Yeah.
Well, what you do is you start off with a square box, and then you start piling the sandbags up in a certain way so that if a mortar round hits, that you're more protected. And also when you're firing the machine guns out of the turrets, the openings down below, that there's less chance of somebody hitting you with a bullet. And so the 15,000 sandbags was, it might have been overkill, but this is what we built. And so we got all of that stuff done. And then I started out working in in avionics. I had to fill a position there, so I learned about radios, and that got boring because I'm not the type of guy that just sits. So then they needed somebody in hydraulics, so I filled a position there for a while, and that was even more boring. And finally, the company was more established, so they made me an acting NCO, an E5.
What did you say they made you an acting?
It's called an acting sergeant.
So what were your duties as the acting sergeant?
Okay, well, after I got that, then they made me the security NCO, and I was responsible for the whole perimeter out in front of us, and all of the munitions and stuff that we put out front. So if there was a ground attack, because we used to have, we had foo gas, which is like a jelly. It's almost like napalm, but it's in a 55-gallon drum. And you put a Willie phosphorus grenade behind the barrel, and then behind that, you put a Claymore mine. And then when you ignite that, the jelly would go out, and it's on fire, and it sticks, you know, it sticks to people, and it ruins your day.
Ouch. So what branch did you say you were serving in?
The 101st Airborne Army.
Okay, thank you. And so what was training like for the war?
Training?
Yeah.
Well, basically they ran us through, how to field strip your weapons. Because when we first went in, the M14 was used, and then right after that, we learned how to field strip a M16.
So, and what is field stripping?
It's taking the whole gun apart and cleaning it and oiling it, so that the weapon was always at ready to use. And then we got introduced to grenades. They used to give you a live grenade to throw, but they had an accident where, because you're supposed to pull a pin and throw the grenade. Well, one day somebody threw the pin and dropped the grenade, and somebody got hurt. So that's when they went to dummy grenades. Then you would learn hand-to-hand combat, basically how to take an enemy down without firing a shot. You know, this it's almost like karate type stuff. And the person who was the fastest, not necessarily the strongest, but knew the right moves, would be the ultimate victor.
So how would you describe the other soldiers that you worked with while you were in Vietnam? The other soldiers that you worked with?
Well, they were from all different parts of the country. You had all different nationalities. Generally, everybody got along. But when I was there, it was a time when the coloreds were making their statement. And so if you told them to do something, they would say, you're being prejudiced. In other words, they used the wildcat to try to manipulate what they would do and wouldn't do. And also, when I was there, you had all of the drugs, and basically half of the company was smoking dope and the other half of the company was drinking. So eventually it began to clash because, you know, when you're laying there in your bunk at night and all of a sudden a marijuana cloud comes in over your bunk and that's all you can smell all night, you know, it starts to create a little bit of friction.
So on the topic of things like that, who would you say was the most memorable person you met?
I would have to say the general that came out and looked at my work out on the bunker line. Because for somebody to take the time out of a day to come out and look at what I had accomplished, I mean, here I am, a young guy. You know, I mean, it made my day.
That's awesome. So what did you, besides drugs, what did you and the other soldiers do for fun?
Well, we would go into town, and they had what they call massage palace. And basically, you go in and get a steam bath, and then you would go and get a massage, amongst other things. And then we got to go to the PX. We had a Bob Hope show that came over. He came over on Christmas time. But basically, it was like you partied in your downtime. We had an NCO club up top. They had a couple of slot machines in them. That was my first introduction to slot machines. But as I became a sergeant, then I could go on the NCO side of the club, and I got a little more benefits than the enlisted men. And so, you know, there wasn't a whole lot as far as what you would call fun, but it's what we created.
So walk us through the barracks where, when you weren't out, where you spent your day. Like, what do you see? What does it look like?
Well, when you walk through the barracks, there was about, let's see, 2, 4, 6, 8. We'll say 18 sets of bunks. And, you know, it was basically, you know, 18 guys in a hooch. And with we had mosquito nets that you put up at night over you so that you didn't get bitten because they had malaria and other such things over there. And everybody would have their flak jacket, their M16, along with their bandolier of bullets for the weapon. And then some people would have a boom box, but there was no TVs. Sometimes we play poker.
So, what would you say was your happiest memory from the war?
I would have to say when I went home on my first leave, I had served 13 months, so I was getting a 30-day leave to come home. So being able to get on the plane and come back here and get real hamburgers, real food, and seeing real people, not somebody that you had to be concerned about day to day, because they all looked alike over there. And coming home and being able to see some of the people I grew up with.
So, what would you say was your darkest memory from the war?
I would say the darkest memory of the war was when we came home. There were the peaceniks, and when we got off the plane, they spit on us. They called us baby killers and whatever else other garbage that you could think of. And to serve that long overseas fighting a war, to come home and get that kind of treatment by the American people, I think that was pretty dark.
So, what would you say was your happiest memory of the war if you're not counting things that involve going home? Like, what was your happiest memory while you were in Vietnam?
Well, I got to go on what they call it's called a mini R&R. In other words, you get 3 days off. So that they would fly you down to like China Beach. That was down Da Nang. And down there, you were able to sit on the beach. The Air Force was there, so you did get real burgers. And basically, you're just able to just veg out, not be concerned about anything.
And just what would you say was your darkest memory? Again, not counting going home and having the people be not nice.
I'd say that one of my darkest memories was seeing people needlessly killed when there were other ways to go about defeating the enemy.
What do you mean by that?
Well, I don't know. Have you ever watched the movie Hamburger Hill?
No.
Okay. Well, basically, the Viet Cong were at the top. The Americans were on the bottom. They would send these guys up. Okay, well, they got rain, so then it turned into mud. Well, these guys were getting picked off one by one. So then we would retreat. Then they would go back up. Multi people got killed again. Finally, we get to the top. The Viet Cong aren't there. And then as soon as we get to the top of the hill and stuff, they go back down, hop on the helicopters, and go back to base. Now, if you're going to have that many people killed for a hill, wouldn't you think it would be wise to occupy that hill
Yeah.
rather than have to go back and take it back in another month? I mean, there are many things that I saw that it was just needless.
So, what would you say you're most proud of that you did during the war?
I'm damn proud of everything that I did over there.
Is there anything specific?
Well, I received numerous medals. I got Bronze Stars, Army Accommodation medals, all for doing stuff against the enemy, participating in what we used to do, what you call a sweep. In other words, you'd get like 100 soldiers and you'd line them up down the road, and then you would go in through the jungle. And what you're looking for is you're looking for the enemy. Also, you're looking for caches of weapons, anything that has to do with trying to stalemate the Viet Cong and the NVA.
So out of all of the medals that you said that you received, which one would you say that you're proudest of, and what did you do to earn it?
I would have to say the Bronze Stars. And basically, I got those in for doing more than what I was supposed to as far as against hostile forces in Vietnam. I worked with battalion. I worked with Sergeant LaJoy, and basically we coordinated all of the sweeps, and we actually went out on night patrols also.
So after your first tour, did you go back?
Yes, I did.
Why did you re-enlist?
Because I didn't like this country.
Could you elaborate on that?
Well, basically, when I got back here, it seemed like everybody was anti-Vietnam. Even when I got back here to the Cape, people back here in the Cape would treat you like garbage. And, you know, you're saying to yourself, is this what I really want to come back to?
So you thought that you didn't want to stay here because everybody was just being mean and nasty?
Yep.
So you said that the better alternative was to go back and continue in the war effort?
I felt safer over there.
Wow. So what position did you serve in your second tour?
I was security NCO.
So what did you do on a day-to-day basis in that?
Okay, what I would do when I get up, we go have breakfast. Then I would go out to the bunker line, and I would make sure that I go through it bunker by bunker, making sure that all of the electrical and stuff worked, because you had all of these panels in there, and you had those, I don't know if you've ever seen them in the movies, it's like a clicker. It makes an electrical current, and it what it does on the claymores, it fires claymores, it would fire the foo gas. So they're all set up in front of you, so if there's a ground attack, all you've got to do is go boom, 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 boom. So I had to make sure everything worked. I had to check all of the trip wires, which would go to flares. So if somebody was coming in through the wire, what they would do is if their foot got tangled in the trip wire, it would ignite a flare and light up that whole area so that you're able to see who's trying to come through. And then I would check in with Sergeant LaJoy and find out whether we were going to do anything as far as, you know, day patrols and stuff like that. But the second tour, I was out with a E6. We used to call them shake and bakes. In other words, they went through NCO school, and they became a sergeant when they came out. They were taught by the book. Well, they came over to Vietnam thinking they were going to win the war by the book. Well, unfortunately, you don't win the war by the book. So we were out there one day, and we were making our sweep. And being over there as long as I was very observant of everything that went on the ground and in the sky. Well, I happened to look up, and there was a loach. It looked like a bumblebee. And basically what the loach does, it flies treetop level to draw enemy fire. And then there's a Cobra gunship that's higher up. He'll radio back up and he'll come down and he'll start firing his rockets, his miniguns, whatever he had on the chopper. So I looked up and I saw the loach and the Cobra gunship. And I'm thinking, this doesn't look good. So I saw the loach start to bank. And I turned around to the E6 and I said, you better radio in and have somebody tell them that we're here. So the load started coming down. Then I saw the Cobra gunship start to bank. And the E6 was on the radio. He finally got battalion. Battalion finally got a hold of the two choppers. The Loach landed and said, "You guys don't know how close you came." And I said, "Yes, I do." And he says, "Nobody told us you guys were out here." So they thought we were the enemy. So we could have been friendly fire casualties.
Wow. So after your second tour, did you go back?
Yep.
So how many tours did you do in total?
Three.
So why did you re-enlist the third time?
Again, because I felt safer. I knew my job. I knew, you know, where my safe places were. Back here in the States, it was a catch-22.
So what position did you serve on your third tour?
I was still a sergeant, but on my third tour, towards the end, they offered me a field commission to second lieutenant.
So what was that like, the field commission to second lieutenant?
I said no.
Oh, okay.
Because it was my third tour and I wanted to go home. And, you know, enough was enough.
So did anything happen differently on your second and third tours than in your first tours?
Well, things got a little more intense. When I first got there, I had two other brothers there. My twin was there, and my older brother Huey was down in Cameron Bay. Now, when the Sullivan brothers served in World War II, and there was a whole bunch of them that died, they said that multiple brothers couldn't serve in Vietnam or in a war. So I had to sign a waiver on my first tour saying that I wanted to volunteer to go.
So do you think that was a result of, was that a result of that it was your second and third tours, the increased intensity, or was it just, basically what I'm asking is, had somebody been going on their first tour,
yep,
during your second and third tour, would it have been more intense for them as well? Or was the increased intensity a result of you going on multiple tours?
Well, I there was the intensity of the multiple tours, but also Hanoi wanted South Vietnam. There was no ifs, ands, buts about it. So they would step up their attacks on all of the different bases and stuff. I got to watch firsthand. I had gone down to visit my twin down in Duc Pho, and we had a full-fledged ground attack. They sent in mortars, and then it was almost like watching ants. I mean, there were hundreds of them. And this was the Viet Cong and the NVA. They were advancing towards the perimeter. And it was just like unbelievable. And then the next thing you know, out of the sky, there was an airplane, a C-130, that they called Puff. And it had mini guns on each side of it. And what it would do, it would come in and it would bank and fire the mini guns. Well, they could fire up a bullet every square inch of a football field. So anything within the football, you know, length, width, is dead. So they would come in and they would fire, and then they would bank the other way and fire the other set of miniguns. And then the next thing you know, the enemy just, they took off.
Wow. So so my next question was, did you see combat in any of the three tours? But I think you've already answered that.
Yep.
Like, how much combat would you say you saw compared to on each tour? Did you see more in different in your second and third than in your first?
Well, the thing is I think I saw more than some people in my company, because I was I moved around. So I was in more every place that I went, it seemed like it was getting attacked. I landed one night in a company, and the guy on the ground says, "You better not say we're going to get overrun." And I was on the last chopper that was headed out. So I always wondered to this day, you know, what happened to all of them? You know, did they make it out?
So I know that you have seen combats and you have been there for combats. Did you ever, were you ever in the combat? Did you ever, like...
Face to face?
Yeah.
No.
Okay. So what types of people would you say you met, like, on different tours? Were there different types of people depending on when you went?
I got to meet, I got to work with a, what do they call them? It wasn't the CIA. It was an organization that investigated within the Army. In other words, if they felt that there was something unscrupulous going on, they were interested in finding, you know, who was selling the drugs to the troops. So I worked with him for a while. The Vietnamese people, a lot of the Vietnamese people were very nice. But it was a case of they all looked the same. So who do you trust? You know, they would call you number one when your face is turned to them. And then they would call you number 10 when you turn your back. And everything was about the money.
So are you still in contact with anybody from the war?
Actually, a lot of the guys that I served with are in bad shape. So as far as contact, no.
When was the last time you saw anybody other than your relatives that you were in the war with?
I haven't seen them in, God, it's going to be 40-some-odd years.
So, like, what was it like seeing them? Was it, like, when did you last see them? Not like a time frame, like, where were you when you last saw them?
When we landed in Seattle, Washington, we were just coming back from our last tours in Vietnam, and we went to a bar to have a drink. We'd just gotten out of the service, and we went in to have a drink, and there was a big family sitting around a bunch of tables, and they invited us over. They paid for our meals, our drink, and everything else. But then the next day when we got on the planes, that was the last time we saw each other.
So, this question, I'm not sure why, I've just been thinking it since you started talking about the restaurant. What did you guys talk about after all that time in Vietnam? Like, what did you talk about when you were at the restaurant?
Everything but the Vietnam War.
So, after you got home, what did you do?
Well, when I got home, I found a job.
Where did you work?
I did landscaping. I drank very heavy for 5 years. When I got back here, it was very dull. So I did my job. Usually after work, you know, we would hit like the Chatham VFW. And a lot of times you would drink from, we'll say, 4 o'clock till 1 or 2 in the morning.
Wow.
Yeah. And I was like a banty rooster. I would get into barroom fights. And this was my way of dealing with the Vietnam War when I first got back. But it took me 5 years to, you know, unwind.
So you said that it was 5 years. What do you think made the change where you stopped drinking heavily?
Well, somebody asked me one day if I thought I had a problem. And I looked at him and I said, "Who, me?" And then I was down at the Bali Neck Inn in Orleans. There was a New Year's party. And somebody did something to my drink. So I went after him. And as I went out the door, chasing him, all of a sudden somebody grabbed me by the shoulder. Well, my first instinct was to hit him. Well, I turned and I saw the blue sleeve. And now, who do you think that could have been?
Who?
The police. So I got locked up that night for protective custody. The next day I got out, I quit cold turkey. That was it.
And what have you done since then, like, aside from your landscaping job?
Well, let me see. I've done drywall. I did that probably about 5 years. I went into my own business. I did, construction. I mean, my first job when I went into business was to redo the inside of a whole house. That's, trim, re-sheet rock, change doors. They did a new floor, the whole nine yards. So basically, I made it so I could do almost anything. And I also worked for the town of Orleans Park Department for 9 years. I worked for the Orleans Elementary School for 11 years. And then basically I went back into business for myself again. And then it got to the point where I was basically disabled because of my spine. And so now I'm to the point where I am 100% disabled, and basically I do small things to keep myself moving, keep the mind as sharp as it can be.
Well, thank you so much. This concludes the interview, but thank you for talking with us, and
yep.
Thank you for your service.
Oh, well, thank you.